Hello, hello in UK Health Radio Land. I'm your host, Liz Larson, and normally I'm here with my friend Bill McKenna, but he's got the day off and he'll be joining us again next week. We'll miss him. However, I couldn't be more pleased to be having this conversation today. It's a topic that's near and dear to my heart. And I didn't even realize how near and dear until I started talking to our guest today, who is Anne Heschen. Welcome, Anne.
Great to be here. Looking forward to it.
I am so excited to talk to you today. So when we were talking off the camera today, Anne told me that she's a healer, a medical intuitive, but also a specialist when it comes to sales and sales language. So this is a very unique combination.
Yeah.
And yeah, it really is. Heart-centered, soulful sales expert is what she said specifically. And we started the most fun conversation about how healers are being called to the planet right now.
Yes,
and how they come up against a hurdle. Welcome, and tell us a little bit about yourself and how you are addressing this hurdle. And maybe tell our audience, what is the hurdle healers are coming up against?
Sure. Well, I think there's a lot, but I totally agree. I think we have a wave happening in the world of openness to energy healing, of healers feeling called to do it, of people realizing that that's very real and very valid. And it's really important part of health is to include that energetic component. I think it's just, you know, we could talk about that for a while. I think the signs are there if you're looking for them. Like, did you know you can get professional liability insurance as an energy healer? You couldn't get professional liability insurance as an energy healer 30 years ago. Like, that wasn't a thing, right? Like I said, the signs are there. And one of the things that comes with this interest in it and people feeling called to do it and realizing they do have these intuitive skills and these abilities to really help people heal at an energetic level is that they really want to do it, and they want to be able to have that be all they do. In other words, to make a living at it, right? You found, you know, it's funny. I when I talk with healers, one of the things that I often say to them that's sort of a relief, that they've been like trying to build a business, right? Trying to get clients, and they tend to get very frustrated. They find a lot of times what they're being taught around sales and around marketing and the things to do feels inauthentic to them. It doesn't feel right. It doesn't feel, you know, like how they want to be. It's super uncomfortable. And I think there's a lot of reasons for that. But one of them is that most people who feel called to be a healer are not actually entrepreneurs. They're not entrepreneurial people, right? They're doing it not because they just want to have their own business, but they're doing it because they found something that they feel is their soul's calling on the planet, right?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
if they could just get a job doing energy healing, they would, but there's no jobs out there for energy healers, right? So they're in this position where they're trying to shove their heart-based, soul-inspired, woo-woo selves into these like marketing models and funnels, and you know, that just weren't made for people like them, people like us, right? And so to me, it's like, you know, here's the deal. You're probably not an entrepreneur. A few of them are, like I am, right? But you're a soulpreneur. You are someone who, and it's a, you need a different path. You need a different way of doing business that it works for you. And so I think that's one of the things that is so frustrating, is they're trying to follow a path that is just not the right path for them.
Yeah. And you know, it's so many people's deep secret, dark, deep secret that they want to be a healer,
mm-hmm.
that they don't tell anyone. They find themselves even embarrassed about it.
Oh, totally.
Yeah. I mean, we hear so many people say that, like, I'm afraid for my family to find out that I'm a healer. There's a little stigma around it still.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, you were saying earlier to me that, you know, there's a wave of healers being called, and it could really launch us into the future, or it could end. And this is the hurdle I was talking about. This is where it could end. If people have the idea that, number one, becoming a healer means you have to have a business. And number two, that becoming a business part just slaps them right in the face and ends it. They just can't do it. So let's break those apart if we can first, Anne. Let's talk about, what is a healer? What are we talking about? A healer. And then second, let's talk about the business part of it.
Yeah.
I want to start that by saying, I always say, you don't have to have a business to be a healer.
Yeah, you know.
Start healing. What is your opinion about that?
Well, yeah, I think there's a difference between you can be a healer and have no interest in actually creating a business doing it. You have something, either you know, perhaps you don't need to earn money, you're being supported in some other way, or you have some other way to earn your keep that you also enjoy, and you're totally good with that, and you just want to do this as a separate thing. And that's great. If that's your situation, great. You know, and this is, I think this whole thing about there being sort of this wave and this being reemergence is still relevant for you. But the people that I'm really here to help are the ones who do want to have a business. They would so love to be able to either, you know, leave that other thing they're doing or quit that job that they may enjoy, or they may not, but this they love, right? They love the healing work they do. And so it's like their dream that if that's what I could do, if that's like that's what I do all day, is I just work with people and I see their lives transform and I could make a living doing that. So they're like, that would be heaven. And those are the people that I'm here. I'm called here to serve. Like, it's become clear to me over the last few years, I'm really here to heal the business of healing.
Yeah. And we really need the bridge.
Yeah.
Really need that to fill the gap of the how to get there. But I think more than that, we have to change the thinking around it.
Yes.
So first, if you're thinking that you want to become a healer, maybe a Reiki master, maybe a cognitive movement practitioner like us, you know, maybe you're thinking that you want to even become an acupuncturist, that would fall under the category as well. Mm-hmm. I mean, a person could maybe become a naturopath, or you could become a psychic intuitive, a medical healer, an herbalist.
It's such a doing shamanic healing. That's something that I have to do, right? So I have a number of different modalities that I work with when I work with people, and shamanic healing is one of them. I've, you know, studied with someone with that and incorporate that in what I do. It can be, you know, applied kinesiology and, you know, doing muscle testing and helping to, you know, and shifting, working with there's so many. And when I say energy healing or intuitive and energy healing, it's a huge umbrella of things that fall under that. 100%.
Yeah, absolutely. So what we're talking about is this call to really serve others in changing their life. So some people really talk about healing in terms of medical, but other people are talking about really changing your soul, your thoughts, your mind. Yeah. And then other people are even talking about more on a higher level, changing realities, changing timelines. That's one of my favorites.
Yeah, absolutely.
But I'll tell you, one of our practitioners, she's funny. Well, we have two that kind of fit in this category who have a real high level job, high power job. One of them is as an engineer. Mm-hmm. And she became a practitioner so she could help the other engineers with some of the things that get them stuck, things that they get in their heads over, things that they have self-esteem issues about. Arguments with each other. What brought her to us is she had somebody at work she was fighting with. She did a session and went back to work. And the next day, that person literally became her best friend. She's like, okay, we need this in the office. So when you're thinking about becoming a healer, keep this story in the back of your mind. Could you integrate what you're actually doing? So there's one way. And you know what happened to me? And I've been an entrepreneur my whole life. My first micro business, I was 14. But I was born a healer, naturally born that way. But I fought my whole life against it. That's how I
That's
ended
true
up.
for a lot of people, especially if it wasn't encouraged, if it wasn't understood, right? Yeah.
Yeah, I fought my whole life against it. So I became an entrepreneur. At one point, I ran car dealerships. You know, I was the CEO of a car dealership. So the two things came together for me quite easily because my brain was already there. But let's really start to talk about where people bump up against this. One thing I hear a lot is, shouldn't healing be free? Should people be charged?
Yeah, I love that you brought that up. And I do run up against that sometimes, that people have a belief, right, that's been taught to them or it's been inculcated, this idea of like, if your healing is, if it's spiritual in some way, if it's like a gift and it's been given to you, then it's actually morally wrong to charge for it. Okay. So I have run into that. I never personally got that belief rained on me. So I was going to say a more crude word.
A sentence enhancing word.
But I definitely know that that's there for some people. So first of all, I'm never going to tell someone like, you know, your belief is wrong. Like if that belief's working for you, great, right? And in my experience, when that's come up and we look at it, there's usually a concurrence that it's not working for
them, right? It's not working.
I mean, think about it. It's sort of like with ideas like that, it's like it's a belief like bring it out in the light of the day, right? Instead of how it just run, it's running things from back here, right?
Yeah.
So bring it out in the light of day. Let's see. Does this have legs? Like, does this, you know, is this hold water? And to me, it's like, first of all, if the idea is because it's a gift, it's wrong. Well, by that argument, an artist shouldn't be able to sell their art, right?
Yeah,
a writer
right?
shouldn't be able
Good
to sell
point.
Books because they have a
Good
gift.
Point.
So that to me is like, okay, well, that's right. And then it's like, well, no, it's not because it's a gift. It's more because it's healing. And it's like, if even just from a purely sort of kind of logical point of view, let's say you have sort of a gift. You're very intuitive. You're able to like see, right? Some people can like see in people's bodies and tell things. If you aren't allowed to, if it's somehow wrong for you to charge for that, then you can't do it very much, can you? Because you have to spend most of your time doing something else so that you can earn a living. So you can't make a very big difference in the world.
And I think that's an excellent point, right? It can be a hobby, and that's fine.
Sure, if that's what you want it to be,
it's a
right?
Business. If you know you're gonna do it for free, then you relegate it to hobby. So it would be like a person who is, you know, a mechanic during the day, and goes plays jazz at the club at night. It's a hobby.
And if they're like happy, they're like, I don't actually want the life of a musician. I just love doing it. They pay me a few bucks, and it's fun, right? But if that person's dream, right, is to change the world with their music, and they feel like they can't charge for it, or they can only charge a little, then they'll never change the world with their music. Right?
Yeah, you just can't, because in this world we do have to have money that supports us, and if we're going to do something full time, unless we're sponsored or independently wealthy, there has to be a way to exchange the time for the money needed to support oneself. It's just,
If you can be paid for this extraordinary work that you're doing, that's transforming, changing people's lives, maybe even saving their lives in some cases. If you can be paid for that, then you can do a lot of it, and you can make a big difference, and you can transform many lives. So it's just like, we just got to separate that out. There is nothing wrong with being paid for the value that you bring. And it's funny, you mentioned that time. To me, I like to actually help my clients separate out the time piece and not, they'll get very caught up. I have a whole like training actually about how they price, how they can price themselves, because they tie themselves in knots about
how
they can charge. And I get that, because I used to too.
Yeah.
I've been self-employed most of my life. So when you're self-employed, you have to set your own rate, right?
Yeah.
And I realized over time that I had come up with a way to do that that felt in integrity, it felt authentic, and it felt empowering. And I realized that most people don't have that. So I started teaching it, right? But to me, it's like, you got to, sure, there is a certain amount of time that it does take you to do what you do. right?
Yeah.
Like it doesn't happen in zero time, but you're not being paid for your time. You're being paid for the value that you
For the
bring.
value. It's a
And
really,
it's
really good point.
so important. There's an old story about it's an artist, but it's the idea is basically like someone, you know, business owner and asked a graphic artist if they would come up with a, you know, really important, you know, like a new logo, a new graphic for the thing. And the girl said, sure. And, you know, in like 20 minutes created something really amazing. And then there's like, that's really great. How much do you want for that? And, you know, that's about $1,000. Like, what do you mean $1,000? It took you 20 minutes. It's like, you're not paying for 20 minutes. You're paying for the master's degree in art and the internship
Yeah.
I did with that, you know, award-winning thing and the 20 years that I've been in the field so that I can create something that perfect for you in 20 minutes. That's what you're paying for.
You know, gosh, that is a really, really, really good point that, you know, a lot of times a person has to go to training, which has an expense and a time involved.
Yes.
You know, it's a segment of your life where you go to learn what to do and how to do it well. And that does have a cost to the person doing it. It is really another reason, if we're lining up reasons,
yes,
to charge for what you do.
I mean, I've done thousands of energy
Yeah.
healing sessions at this point. I don't even know how many, but it's definitely in the thousands. I'm better than when I first started, right?
Yeah.
Right. And I still made a big difference when I first started too, right? I deserve to be paid for that too. But like, you're also paying for that. You're paying for the wisdom and the experience. And, you know, and so often what I find with healers is they discount that about themselves. I always say it over again, like, you know, so many healers I work with, they're in their 50s or 60s or even 70s, right? And they're, they just discount that all of that lived life and all of the wisdom that came from that has no value. And it's like, that's the value. Like, yeah, you have your modality, you have your thing that you do, but it's all those years of living that you bring to it. That's what makes the difference.
I love that. The value is who you are and what you bring to the table. And I want to actually back up just a tiny bit.
Mm-hmm.
You made a fantastic point about natural talent. So people who come to the planet with a natural healing ability, I see this as structural, not even a gift that someone, you know, it's not a fairy godmother that bestowed it. It's
Seems
exactly like
yeah.
being able to draw or, you know, play the trumpet or play the basketball. That wasn't right. Play basketball.
Yeah, play basketball. Play
right?
basketball. Yeah, no,
so
yeah.
It's not.
Some people are natural athletes.
Yeah.
Other people, there's some people in the world who became world-class athletes, and it wasn't because they had a lot of natural ability, but they had a lot of drive and they worked really hard and they built their skills. And other people, it's like way more natural. And the same thing with this, right?
Well, I think there's the interest too. So I'm a big believer that we are almost called, we're drawn to a certain thing. Like I was never, ever drawn to be an astronaut. So being an astronaut never came into my field. Like nobody ever said, hey, Liz, I think you'd be a good astronaut. But daily, I got asked the questions that I had no business knowing. And people would say, hey, Liz, you know what? You would be a really great counselor or healer or, right? So who we are plays a big part in this. What is our interest? What are we drawn to? And not everybody wants to be a healer. It's a small amount of people.
Of course. Yeah.
So if you're hearing our voice and you're one of those people who has that as an inkling, you are unique. You described yourself as a unicorn earlier, where you have the entrepreneurial skills and the healing ability at the same time, and education and talent and all of that. So if you're hearing us and you think you'd like to be a person who serves in this way, you're unique.
Yes.
Even just in your interest in it, not everybody has it, right?
Absolutely true. And it also isn't like it could have been never been an interest before, but it is now. Like now you're ready to kind of hear that call. Now that's, it can really be, you know, the kind of healing work we're talking about that I would generally call energy healing, but you know, as like I said, it's a big umbrella term. It doesn't have to, but it just tends to have a really strong spiritual component. Certainly, you don't have to follow any particular religion. I think you could actually be, you know, an atheist or agnostic and still do this. But typically, it's, you know, there's just a spiritual component to it. And very often for people, it occurs like as part of kind of a spiritual awakening and a part of a spiritual sort of flowering and opening up and connecting to whatever it is, you know, the all of it that's bigger than all of us, connecting it to it in your way is very often tied into realizing that healing is a lot more than chemistry and structure. You know?
Yeah, it's a much bigger conversation. Mm-hmm. Our work, Cogna Movement, really would be great for an atheist or agnostic in the beginning because it's very technological. We work in the nervous system. We access the power lines. However, then when your client shows up and leaves and the reality's changed on the outside world, literally a timeline shifted.
Yeah.
Here comes the woo-woo. How do you explain that? So you're right. I think that's maybe another little hurdle people bump up against. Over my lifetime, I've had a lot of people who secretly came, hey, can I talk to you about, I think I'm a healer, but my religion is not going to accept.
Oh, yeah. That. I've heard that a lot. Yes.
So sometimes it's not just the sales part, and which is what we're going to talk about in the next segment. Some part times it really is, it bumps up against what your worldview is and what you know. So let's take our break. We need to hear from the UK Health Radio Network. And when we come back, let's dive into just a little bit more about what this wave is. And let's start to talk about the sales component. Mm-hmm. All right, UK Health Radio, take it away. And we're back. I'm talking with Anne Hessian about a subject that is just so near and dear to my heart, and that is becoming a healer and how to bridge the gap with sales and business. You said off camera that you are writing a manifesto about the wave of healers. What's that about?
Well, I didn't just I want to be clear. I did not set out to write a manifesto. That was not the goal. I never thought of myself as someone who would write. Who thinks that, right?
Right.
But where this started was, you know, really recognizing I feel that there is this growing, it's like an emergence, a reemergence of energetic healing the world. There's a growing interest in it, growing number of people who want it, growing number of people who feel that they're called to do it. I think the signs are there if you're looking for them. And we kind of hit on a little bit. I could give you a lot more signs too. And I feel very strongly that as wonderful as that is, what we can't do is just take that for granted because and just be like, great, let's ride the wave. We have to be thinking ahead. We need to be thinking 20 years, 30 years ahead, because when something that, especially something that has been as decentralized as energetic healing starts to get big, there's particular challenges that come with that. So if I could go deep here, so stop.
Go deep. Let's hear it.
But so energetic, if you look at the history of it, which goes back into prehistory, right? Energy healing is as old as humans. And, you know, it used to be just this big mystery. And then you had the age of science, you know, where a healer was like revered, right? They would be like the shaman and the thing. And then we kind of moved into the age of science. Kind of before the age of science, it started that certainly became very, there was sort of like sanctioned healing, right? Like a priest laying on the hands.
Yeah, right.
The village midwife, you know, doing her herbs, she could get killed for that, right? And we all know that there was a lot of that. So there was, you know, there would get a lot of stuff between religion and different types of healing, right? And that, and that's, you know, in all, many other cultures as well. That's kind of more the, you know, European American example I gave, but, and then we started to morph into the age of science, which, as the scientific method started to develop, you know, it, one of the things that I still see this to the day is how there's something about science that's really intoxicating, right? This promise, like we can understand everything.
Yeah.
Right.
All
and
things.
If you look, you know, like especially kind of as the early, I mean, the scientific method goes back to the, at least the ancient Greeks and Romans, right? But there was a bit more in like, now we're gonna experiment and observe. And so, you know, around like Descartes and Newton, what we had for a long time, there was this very mechanistic view of reality, right? Once we start getting gravity and da, 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 da. And that there's something really intoxicating about that view, because it's, there was sort of this promise that if we just think about this hard enough and we do enough experiments, we'll understand everything. And that's like, we love understanding things, right? Right. And so now, in addition to religion being very down on most forms of energy healing and literally torturing people and killing them for it, right? Mm-hmm. Now you have this emerging, very, you know, seductive scientific paradigm that has this whole other reason to kind of crap all over it, because there was no way you could measure it with what was available in that mechanistic view and the kinds of measurement tools that were available. So it just became, now it's just balderdash and old fashioned and poppycocking, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and superstition.
Yes, right. And so now there's a whole other reason why it's driven underground, but never driven away. And it's ironically two scientific huge breakthroughs that allowed it to reemerge. The first being, well, Einstein. And Einstein opening up the door to quantum physics and the, yeah, you can't explain it all, right? That there's this whole...
Tesla, yeah.
Right? So Tesla, Einstein, you know, the theory of relativity and realizing that it is not, that mechanistic view of the world doesn't cut it, right? And so, you know, relativity, all that. And so that opened up to quantum physics, which is, I mean, if we're going to talk woo-woo, is there anything more woo-woo than quantum physics?
No.
I don't think so. Like nothing, there's nothing more woo-woo than quantum physics, right? And you can explain energy healing through that. So that means now we started to be able to measure things we couldn't measure before. And now they could measure like the monk's brain waves, right? Like you couldn't do that in the 1650s. So the opening of science into the whole quantum thing, now there's an opening there, right? And then the other thing, of course, is the information age, you know, and the internet and the fact that the information can get out there. So if it weren't for those two massive breakthroughs in science, energy healing wouldn't have been able to reemerge.
And now, the results of energy healing can be measured.
Can be measured and proved.
Yeah, yes. What's the change in the brain waves? What's the change in the voltage of the body? Where does the body redirect its energy after one of these sessions? You know, the MEG, the EEG, all measure that energy.
Feedback, the technology that we're coming up with. So outside the body.
What's
happening now is what I think of it, it's like this sort of tentative handshake, you know, between kind of the hardcore science and energetic healing. And I want to turn that into a really solid grasp, right? And so this all started with Mass About the Manifesto. And my contention is that what we do in the next 5 to 10 years, so not a huge window, what we do in the next, or fail to do in the next 5 to 10 years, is going to be the single determining factor in whether or not this current reemergence of energetic healing, intuitive healing in the world, becomes what I would call a true renaissance, where it permeates and really becomes a part of our fundamental understanding of health and healing, or, and this could happen, it gets driven back underground again.
Yeah.
Because it really could, right?
Yeah, I agree with you.
That's why I say, like, we've been, you know, it's like this person's over here doing their teaching their thing, and this person's over here teaching their thing, and this person's over here, and it's all great, but we got to start working together. And that's really what I'm about. Is we're actually forming a nonprofit, and so that we can start working together on these four fundamental sort of pillars, which is like the education and training and standards and stuff, the legal and regulatory. Most energy healers have their heads completely in the sand about that. We have to have a voice in that, because the bigger we get, the more there's going to be regulations. We have to help create them.
Yeah.
And then thirdly, the research. You know, funding more research into the brainwaves and the thing and all that. And then the fourth is my jam. And that's the business side. It's the business of healing, because none of that matters if people can't make a living doing it.
Yeah, you're 100% right. I want to go back to what you were talking about with the science. Also, the other component is science is being shown to not always be accurate as well. We thought the scientific method meant proof, and it doesn't. It means an opinion a lot of times.
Well, we could talk about that for a long time.
Right? You know, personally,
publication bias, the role of money, all that stuff. There's a lot of stuff, right?
Yeah. And I'm really also about challenging some of these ideas in psychology alone. We have Freud and Jung. And if you really look into what they taught, they were just two guys with an opinion, some ideas that really did advance and change what we think about the brain and the mind. But also, they were just two really flawed people, really weird biases that created these foundational ideas. It's time that we challenge those and recognize
it is
ideas. My dad used to call science precision guesswork.
Well, yeah, I mean, it is. And I think we do, you want to look at those things. Like, so, I mean, I was a psychology major, and honestly, nowadays, most people kind of straight up make fun of Freud, and there's a lot to make fun of, let's be honest. But there's also a lot to acknowledge. I mean, he really was the first one, or like among the first to like have us take seriously the idea that things that happened to you in your childhood could continue to affect you for the rest of the life. That was not what people thought back then. Right. So there's some, that's just one example. Right. And so there's things we can learn from each and every and these things. And then you have, behaviorism coming in and B.F. Skinner, and that whole thing. And I actually got here to hear him speak once before he died. That was pretty wild. Just like, this is, wow, someone who changed the whole changed the whole field,
Yeah, absolutely.
Some very valid things, but still just part of the picture.
Yeah. I think we have to have the willingness to question. And to challenge. That's it. Not just say science is science is science, but okay, where did that come from? And all the biases. Anyway, totally different conversation. Yeah. Let's segue into the business part is really what we wanted to talk about today. It's such a huge conversation. I could talk about it for weeks. But in the end, an individual needs to decide, what is the modality? What's the mode in which they want to begin their healing work? And that changes over time. And if they're going to do it and not have it be a hobby, they need to be able to talk about what they do.
They do.
Invite people to work with them and find a way to charge monetarily so they can support themselves. So where do we go with that? How do we start, Anne?
So that's called sales, right? It's like that sales word, right? And I often just kind of joke. So most healers are allergic to sales. They're basically just allergic to it, right? They'd rather crawl into a hole in the ground than have a sales conversation. It's so uncomfortable because it's so personal. And there's a lot of reasons for that, some of which we touched, if you have these beliefs around it's, how do I charge for that? A lot of self-worth issues. So there's a lot of inner like how dare, who am I to do that? Blah, blah, blah. What if they don't like it? What if it doesn't work? All that stuff, right? So there's all that, but there's also that they just don't have the skills. So one of my sort of core things is to help people understand that, look, sales is just a set of skills. It's just a set of skills, and you can learn them just like you learned how to do what you do. You learned how to ride a bicycle. You learned, how to use different tools. You learned how to read and write. You can learn sales. Having said that, what kind of sales? Right? So I have done a lot of sales, and I've done a lot of sales training. And one of the things I can tell you is someone who's done a lot of that and had done sales, and I've sold easily over $4 billion worth of, products and services, my own and other people's, from one-to-one. I don't mean like by sending someone to a website, I mean from a one-to-one sales conversation. So I figured out I've had well over 10,000 one-to-one sales conversations.
Wow.
So I know what I'm talking about, right? And I definitely don't know everything, but this is my area. And if you're listening, if you've ever like, you've kind of realized, yeah, I have to know how to talk. I know how to invite people. I have to be able to give them the price. I have to do sales. And if you've ever gone and done some kind of sales training, And it like it made sense, but then when you tried to do it, it just didn't feel right. Here's probably why. In my experience, most sales training out there in the world still today, although it has shifted, is I feel it's coming from a very outdated paradigm. It's not coming from what I, you know, heart-centered, soulful sales. And it's very, most sales training is very, what I like to call high testosterone. It's very male. It's, you know, if you look at the traditional language of sales, it's like literally overcome their objections. Overcome them? Like, how about address them? Listen to them? See if you can overcome their objections. That is what you're told. There'll be a section in the sales manual. There's the chapter on overcoming objections, right? You know, always be closing. It's this very, you know, look at, you know, you can even, there's classic like Glenn Ross, right? Classic movies about salespeople. And it's like this, right? And it's so, I do want to be clear. I'm not bashing the guys. I love male energy. I have a lot of male energy myself, but it does not work for heart-centered people, male or female, as our way of engaging with people, trying to, you know, serving them and inviting them to work with us.
So how do you like this one? Hit their pain points.
Oh yeah, hit their pain points. Now, discover their pain points in the sense of like, take the time, care enough to find out what it is they're struggling with, how it's affecting them, but not hit them.
Right.
You know, like twist the knife, right? So, but they're very different, right? It is important to find out what it is that's going on for people that they don't want, that is painful or a struggle, if you have something that can help, right? But it's how you do it.
Yeah. I Nikki Roush, who's a sales professional, she said the other day, it's kind of like the hit your pain points is coming at somebody with the edge of an envelope and giving them a bunch of cuts.
Yeah, yeah.
Saying, oh, by the way, I sell Band-Aids.
Oh, yeah.
Like hitting their pain points.
Yeah.
Which is different than what is your why? What are your goals? What are you wanting to achieve? And what can my services do to support you in that is a completely different thing. So I get what you're saying. It's this pushy or push. Yeah. Male energy versus an invitation.
I like to put it as, so traditional sales is very male energy, okay? Heart-centered sales, soulful sales is coming from female energy. And how I like to put it is heart-centered sales is always putting the relationship before the transaction.
And it really comes that.
Right? Relationship first, transaction second. And male energy is focused on the transaction. And there's nothing fundamentally wrong with that. The transaction is also important. But when you're putting the transaction as being primary, you can tell.
So relationship first, transaction second. You can just feel the softness in that.
Yeah,
speaking of sales, speaking of sales, we need to hear from the UK Health Radio Network. They have a few things they might want someone to do or buy. So UK Health Radio, please take it away. And we're back with Anne Hesh, and we're having a great conversation about healers, selling for healers, and the business side of it. So we're talking about how traditional sales models often feel very masculine, the push, versus the invitation, the pull. And so you were saying that relationship first before transaction.
Yeah.
So I love that that shift in thinking. So are you talking about the traditional building rapport or something else?
It's part of it's that, you know, to me, what makes it sales really work is that part of it is that you are just being an actual real human being connecting with another real human being. Now, so you're being you, you're allowing yourself to really be there. You are also playing a role because if it's a sale, if someone has a problem and they've come to you and you sell something, a service or a product that can solve that, you need to, like, you're there as to provide that role, right? Yeah. To serve them, to guide them, to ask the right questions, to share what you know and your expertise, right? So you're being you, you are playing the role, the salesperson, but you're being a real person while you're doing it. That makes sense?
Yeah.
Think of it. I think sometimes Think of like a waiter or a wait staff, waiter or waitress, right? So, which is sales, by the way, you know, to a certain degree. Like some, you know, there's waiters you like, you would always go back to them, right? Because they're so fun and they're just being real with you and right? And then there's some, and then there's others, they're like, they're doing everything they're supposed to do. They ask you all the right questions. They got your order right. They checked back in on you, but there was no human connection, right?
Yeah.
Okay. But at the same time, if you have the waiter who's really fun and they're being really human, but they got your order wrong, they didn't ask the right questions, you still, right? You know, like, so you want the one who's going to be a real person. You know, you may have some fun with them. They see you having a hard day. They go the extra mile. They bring you a piece of pie or whatever. But they also listen and they ask the right questions. And they got your order right. That's what you want in sales.
You know, I just had an aha moment. And what you're saying is so good. And I think you're so right. So many of us, especially if we're coming from a heart-centered service that we're offering, think, okay, in session, we're going to be the person who guides and knows and helps and serves, but there's this uniform we have to put on to sell mm-hmm. it to them.
Yep.
And we're somebody else. We have to become mm-hmm. somebody else. And that's usually somebody who's real awkward.
Yeah, exactly. I don't know how it happens, but it's like they asked about working with me. I got to put my sales hat on. Oh yeah. Shoot, what do I do now? What am I supposed to? I'm supposed to hit their pain point, right? And you just like you go away. You're not there anymore, and they're
yeah,
like,
and you go get you so weird. Yeah, you get so weird. True. So I love that. I mean, just the visual. There's the belief you've got to put on a different uniform instead of just being who you are. So that's lovely advice in just the first place. Yeah. If somebody learned nothing else, but just be who you are, be yourself, be the same person you are in your session when you're offering your service. So I really like that. Appreciate it very much.
And can I just say, it's like one, and that's very important. Sigh relief. And let's be honest, it's not always easy to be yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Right? We get thrown. We get by like, oh, what am I supposed to do now? And so the reason, first I want to paint a little picture. How sales is for me now, I enjoy sales conversations. They're fun. I'm just totally real with the person but I've had a lot of them. Okay. So that's why I've gotten to where I really can just be me. And I've had sales conversations the sales conversation itself was healing. The other person and I were both crying at the end because we got so connected and we were just taking a stand and creating this possibility for it. Right. So that's what's possible in a sales conversation when you're really just being yourself and you have the skills.
Ooh, okay? That's juicy.
One of the biggest reasons why you stop being you when like sale, they ask, oh, how much do you charge? Or tell me about what you do and everything is because you don't know what to do. And it's hard to be present when you're being put on in a situation where you don't know what to do. You don't have the skills the situation requires, right? So that's why it's important to also learn the skills.
Okay. So you said that, you told me off camera as well, that you have a gift for everyone where they can get some steps for where to start.
Yeah.
So would you tell everybody live what might step one be? Where do you begin?
So I would love to teach you this. So this is kind of like, it's a trap that most people fall into when someone inquires about working with you. They want to find out about whatever it is you do or whatever it is you sell or offer, if you know, it could be a product or service. And they, in some way, they are asking you to tell them more, right? They're like, how does that work? Tell me more about that. That's interesting, right? And it all comes down to in some way they're inviting. So I call it the tell me more trap, okay? And most people fall right into this trap every time, and then they can't get out of it. And they kill off the potential sales conversation before it even starts.
Mm-hmm.
So here's how it goes. Someone says, oh yeah, tell me more about what you do. And then what do most people do? Right?
Word they just vomit.
Air hose, verbal vomit. Oh my God, they're interested. Your brain's like, woohoo, they're interested. This is so great. And you start, you know, like, and here's part of why we do, a lot of people do it anyway, you know, even if they're not as in love with what they do as we are, but we love what we do, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Love it. You love it. I could geek out about energy healing for hours because I love you. Get me with another healer. We're like, oh my God, just know about this. Right. Because so we started. That's part of why we do it is because we really are that interested in it,
Right.
but they're not. Right. So we'll start going on and on, right? Oh, like where you studied and how this happened and where it came from and these results. And we'll just like, we'll go on and on. And their eyes are starting to like, oh my God, I didn't, right? And we've all had it done to us too. We've all been at the networking thing and you ask someone and then like 10 minutes later, 15 minutes later, they're still talking. You're like, oh my God, dude, I did not want to know all that, right? So that's the first thing that's the first mistake. You fall into the tell me more trap. So here's what to do instead. And if you change nothing except this will make a huge difference. When someone says, oh, wow, that's interesting that you do energy healing or coaching, whatever it is, tell me more about that, or how'd you get into that, or something like that. You say, I would love to, but first tell me what interests you about that. And then you zip it, right?
Brilliant.
Really, people, that's a writer downer, right? Oh, I'd love to, but first, what got your attention? Right. Or I'd love to, but first, what got your interest about it? And then you listen. Okay. The thing is, we tend to jump to thinking they asked because they want to hire us. And like they're several steps away from that, typically. They might just be being polite. They might have a friend who they think might be interested. They might have a cousin who they think is maybe studying the same thing you do, and they're just trying to figure out if what you do is the thing their cousin's studying. Those are three very different conversations, right? So unless you find out why they want to know more, the odds of you giving them something that would be useful and interesting to them are like slim to none.
Exactly. And with healing, alternative healing methods, you really have no idea what people know or don't know. They think alternative healing means a vitamin, my vitamin C. And
Yeah.
you may be talking about changing the universe through your nervous system, right? Like you really need to ask that question. I love it. So tell me more about what you want to know, like how do we formulate that sentence?
Yeah. So, like I said, I would recommend if they're saying, please tell me more, or what can you tell me about it? You don't want to sound cagey, which is why I like to put the I'd love to at first, right? So you're like,
Yeah.
absolutely, I'm happy to tell you, but first, it could be what got your attention about it, or is there anything is there anything specific? Or although that can kind of, I don't usually say, is there something specific you want to know? Because that can kind of put them on the spot. If they don't know anything, then they're like, I don't even know what to ask, right? So instead, I just like, what got your interest, right? Or what caught your attention about that, or something like that, and they'll answer, right? And they might just indicate that they're just being polite. And
Yeah.
okay, great. Then that's not a, I like to teach this in terms of, it's kind of like a red light, green light, of like where they want the conversation to go. Sometimes you really should just talk about something else. They're not interested.
Yeah.
Okay. But if they are, they're like, well, I was wondering if, I've had this thing with my back. I'm kind of wondering. I heard somebody got, so I was kind of wondering. So that still isn't, that doesn't mean now it's time for you to fire hose them. It's never time to fire hose them, ever.
Yeah.
But that's when you, oh, well, tell me more about that. Like, so sales is 90% asking questions and listening to the answer, and maybe 10% telling them things.
I think that's the biggest misunderstanding.
Yeah.
A person who is trying to sell their service, really not even trying to sell their service, they're really trying to serve the person. And there's a cost for that. I think that's what it is. Like, I think people are never considered themselves a salesperson, and yet they find themselves in this position, is that you think you've got to tell them everything when really what they want is to be heard. And the more a person feels heard, feels seen,
Yeah.
the more they trust you and like you, the more they're going to lean into like asking for your service.
Exactly.
That's
This
a beautiful place to
and
be.
how that happens is that you make the conversation about them. all the problem they're here, they're in our own head, where we're all caught up, like, what do I say now, right? But when we get out our own head and we just get over there in their world, then most of the problems just kind of disappear. And how you do that is by asking questions more than anything else, right? So it's, yeah, I'd love to tell me what interests you about that. And if they do share something about themselves, and, oh, wow, how long has that been going on? You know, like, what else have you tried for it?
Yeah.
That sounds really hard. Does that keep you, you know, from doing, you know, yeah, you know, and then you can kind of also find out what they'd like instead, you know, what they would like to be. And then it's a part way in, you know, when they're really seem interested, that's when you can tell them like two sentences about what you do. Not the process. And that's the other thing, is we like to tell people the process. Well, I go through this and then I just chart and then I run a magnet here and then I do my pendulum over here. Like, they don't care. Right? It's just, you know, I do this, we do this. And then usually this is what happens. Is that the kind of thing you're looking for? Right. And they're like, yeah, all right, let's do it.
So I cannot believe it, but we've actually run up against the end of our time for UK Health Radio Network. I want to make sure that everyone knows where to find you and that there's more steps that people can actually get in a free PDF.
Yeah, that was step one. So if you want all the steps, and actually there's 5 or 6 steps depending on the circumstance. And that's where I would like to give it to. So share with you my sales conversation secrets, heart-centered sales. It's simple. And it's just a download that really just walks you like micro step through micro step. So you really understand it, how to have that sales conversation with someone. So they want to work with you. And can I say, or not? Because not everyone wants to work with us, but it's clear, and it will keep you from trying to sell to someone who isn't interested.
You know,
able to sell to someone who is.
It's really, really important for sales, for people who are selling a service like healing, to understand that not every client is for them either.
Yeah, absolutely.
To work with me, you have to go through a little process so that we know together, is it a good fit? What I do may not be the right fit. And then I have this great group of people that I refer to.
Yes, exactly. And sometimes I just like, I don't feel like I'm the right person for them. So I refer to them elsewhere. And this process helps with that as well, because it's really about serving them and finding out what's going on with them and guiding like your job in sales, in the sales part of what you do, is really to guide people to a decision of yes or no that's in their best interest. And sometimes no is what's in their best interest, and sometimes yes. But it's like, to me, it's like I always want to help people come to either a clear and empowered yes or a clear and empowered no. And those are both wins as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah. So people can find that at soulpreneurssuccesscode.com and then /SC. S. soulpreneurssuccesscode.com/SCS. And if Anne is willing, we'll actually continue our conversation just a little longer. Speaking of sales, we need to hear from the UK Health Radio Network. They have a few things they might want someone to do or buy. So we're back on New Life Perspectives Radio with Liz Larson and Bill McKenna, the team that created the Cogno Movement System. And we're in our extended conversation with Anne Heshen, who is a soulpreneur, a specialist in helping healers, people in the healing industry, feel comfortable with selling and sales with actually getting paid for their services. It's massive. And we were kind of joking off camera about your manifesto. I just love that word. It's kind of badass, right? You're not saying...
I have to make myself step into it a little bit. Like,
I'm not writing a book or an essay. I'm writing an effing manifesto.
Yep.
So the idea is, if I understand correctly, that there's a wave of people coming on the planet or just becoming active.
Sure. Yeah. Some of them have been on the planet for a long time, right? But now they're realizing, wow, you know, this is what I'm here to do.
Yeah, and you're talking to specifically people who not only understand that they have a healing ability or interest, it can be learned, absolutely, but the desire to do it for their career or to support themselves.
Yes.
So we were talking earlier in this episode about sales as a big roadblock, for one, and that's something you help people overcome. But are there other forces on the planet right now that could kind of quell this wave or stop it from really taking root?
I mean, I think so. I think we look at history, the history of healing and medicine and all that in particular, but of other things as well. You know, it's not always, hasn't always gone the way that I think it should, right? So I, you know, in the manifesto, we kind of really look at that, the whole kind of history, the prehistory. I mean, I think the things that I'm now calling energy healing in that umbrella, like that's not the term they would have used, you know, 800 years ago or whatever, but those things, right? Use of, manipulation of energy itself, intuiting and being able to use those intuitive, abilities that we all have, and some have just developed more than others, use of crystals and other natural substances, use of herbs, use of, you know, the moving the chi and the, or the prana or whatever, you know, but different cultures will call, you know, all of those things. I think it's as old as human beings, right?
Yeah. And there were times in history when even just a midwife or a doula, somebody assisting in birth, would have fallen under that category. At least now we know better than that. Right?
Yeah. So there's a long history of persecution and a lot of people who would identify with that term of healer now. And also, by the way, many who they wouldn't call themselves healers. They might feel like that more like I'm a coach or something like that.
Yeah.
But they're still coming from this it is healing. There is healing in what they do, right? Even if they wouldn't adapt themselves as healers, we know from history what happened, right? Tens of thousands, if not more, people tortured, murdered, Spanish Inquisition, Salem witch trials, yada yada, right? And in many, many cases, some of it, I'm sure it was entirely random and people being vindictive, but in many cases, it was, you know, they were the village wise woman, right?
Yeah.
And they had symbols and their things. So we know that from history. I think we inherited that through our lineage, right? So, you know, as I and many other energy healers, we run into inherited things where it's like, oh my God, this energetic pattern, this wound goes back 80 generations or five generations or whatever it does, right? And then for those who believe in past lives, and I know not everyone does, and that's fine. Same thing, right? It's like, whether it's from past life or inherited, I don't care. It's here now, right? And so we have that. There's that healer persecution complex. There's this absolute terror of being visible as a healer, because last time you did that, they cut your head off.
Yeah.
I mean,
in our recent history,
it's not like that long ago.
Yeah. Right? We still see movies about it. We know, you know, not that long ago, you know, whole towns of women were murdered because there was a suspicion.
Just a suspicion. Exactly. Right.
Yeah. And I think, you know,
Sorry, go ahead.
The religious persecution that somehow your ability to be a wise woman, the woman in town who knew about the herbs, who knew how to birth the babies, who maybe knew how to make a tincture or an oil, or who maybe understood human nature and gave some advice,
some
that
intuition,
would help you.
Right? Understood. Right. Natural cycles. And it's very, obviously it's deeply rooted in very systemic misogyny as well. It was the vast, certainly there were men also, but the vast majority were women. It was about power. It was about a lot of things, right?
When I had my son, I did a thing called hypnobirthing. Boy, at the time, that was so woo-woo for me. Oh my goodness. You know, it taught me everything. But I read in the book that came along with that, that there was a time in history when the only person allowed to attend a birth was a priest. Mm-hmm. And this was, you know, in a certain part of Europe, they wouldn't even allow other women or midwife. And then they decided it was so disgusting that not even the priest could attend.
Right.
You know, it was, even birth was some sort of witchcraft, which makes me kind of wait, take a little left turn. Okay. And I don't know how you feel about this. And I want to encourage people to fight with me about it. Tell me what you think. But there is this movement that people, healers, especially female healers, mm-hmm. are reclaiming the word witch.
Ooh, yeah, yeah. That's
and I'm opposed. So I don't know how everybody else feels, but if anybody knows what I look like, I tend to have the appearance that might lead you to believe that that might be my nature. and you know, I have people that I work with doctors and physical therapists, and they will say to their clients, I'd like to introduce you to somebody who I think is a witch. Mm-hmm. And I say, absolutely not. No, thank you. Mm-hmm. Because I don't like the word that I think has been used mm-hmm. to villainize and victimize so many of us who have natural healing abilities. I think it brings us back. So I correct and I say, no, actually, I'm a healer. I don't do witchcraft. I'm not mm-hmm. a practicing Wiccan. Not that there's anything wrong with that, if that's who you
are. I think for a lot of people, like for that, that's actually their religion, right? And what they mean by witch is something very different than what other people mean. And so, I think you have to find it for you. I mean, I have often joked when I'm doing healing work with someone, I might do something in the work and I just kind of go, yeah, this is what I would have been burned at the stake for 300 years ago. Oh, right. Yeah. Right. And I mean, it's a joke, of course, but it's also not. But to me, I don't care as long, it depends on how it's met. I quite frankly feel this, similar word, actually the word bitch, I stopped relating to that as an insult a long time ago.
Yeah.
To me, it's just like, that's an energy. It's required sometimes. If it's required, I can bring it. If it's not, I won't.
I want to also, and this is just me, and I encourage you guys to fight with me about it. I want to have us seen as professionals as well. And when they even pretend or play around with the word witch, there, it tends to denigrate that idea that you are a professional.
Yeah.
You know, I'm a professional that other doctors refer their clients to. I don't want them thinking I'm a witch. One of them.
I totally get that. Yeah. But for me, it depends on the context and also the person. You know, the whole people should be called what they want to be called.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Which, by the way, that's like the origin. That's really what remember when the term politically correct came about, like, right. That's really, and then it became, you know, a whole thing and a joke and everything. That's really all that ever was refer to people the way they would like to be referred to.
Sure.
When you think about it, that's really all it is. Right. It's just, it's actually just common courtesy. It went a little haywire. But it's just courteous, you know, you don't want that term, so people shouldn't use it for you.
I think it's the connotation too. For me, words really matter. And I never get offended. I know what they mean. And I do laugh, but I always correct a little
bit. But you correct them because it doesn't work for you. And that's good.
And the connotation that there could be something evil or a hex put on someone, which is what we associate with witchcraft, not Wicca, but witchcraft. Is that there could be something negative about it. So for me, it's important to take that connotation out and to really bring up the idea of miracles in my practice and in the practice of our practitioners daily. We'll say, where's my miracle today? Because we experience and witness things that seem outside of the explainable. I think they're perfectly explainable, but there's something that you don't expect and that's not probable, right? Mm-hmm. So I like to shift the conversation in that direction. What becomes available then is a different idea. So for me, that's why I'm opposed to claiming the word witch. Yeah. Now, my husband will say, I say, I'm not a witch. He says, now, would you have been burned at the stake in the past? And I have to say yes. So he says, yeah, exactly.
Well, and it is interesting. And I think the important thing is to be able to talk about it. It's funny, it's about words. So I'm going to say it was like a year and a half ago, I sent in an email to the people on my list, and it wasn't even actually about me. Like, I joke about that I'm a unicorn because I'm an energy healer and a sales expert. That makes me a unicorn. It's just a little joke I tell, right? So it wasn't even about me. It was actually sending an email on behalf of someone else. Like, I was promoting them because they have like wonderful programs, and they, in their email, they had made this unicorn reference. I got an email back from this guy on my list. I think he was in Germany, actually. And he was like, I couldn't believe when I saw your email, don't you know that unicorn is a powerful symbol in the occult of evil, right? And I was like,
oh, Lord.
I'm like, what? Oh. I'm like, unicorns, like sparkly tail, right?
So right? My little pony.
Like, really? but I, you know, I got like, you know, I'm, and so I just replied and said, you know, I understand that's what it means to you. Just so you know, it doesn't mean that to me. If I ever use it again, just know I mean this, right? And I'm thinking that's the end of it. He sent me another email with like an attachment to like, let me educate you about the evil of unicorn and the occult. And I was like,
well, and that's what's important.
I'm not going to read that.
And that's what's important to him. I think, you know, back to your manifesto. Yeah, back to your manifesto idea. For me, this is one of those little things, your little side rant, is that one of the things that does stop many people from becoming a healer is the stigma around it. Like, yeah. Now you're considered a hippie or granola or a witch instead of a professional, which is what we are, that provides a service that really meets the needs of a greater and greater conversation. And to your point, your manifesto, I think we have to elevate the idea so that we can get people there and they're proud to become a healing professional that isn't necessarily a doctor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, 100%. And term that I like to, and that is why, and when I wrote it, I you know, it's grounded in really looking into history, like what got us here, right? And then what do we need to do? And we need to, when I talk about the regulatory side of things, we can't pretend that's not there. But we need to have a voice in that. And we need to, so if we become more self-regulating as an industry, that will help so that we don't have, you know, misunderstood, really punitive regulation, right? So there's things like that where we have to be responsible for that and put those standards in place and have, you know, have things around our education, around what people can and can't do, right? And of course, there won't be 100% agreement on that, but that doesn't mean we shouldn't do it. We have to have those discussions, right? But I will throw in, there is a term that I personally, and not everyone's going to agree on this either, but a term that I want to reclaim, or actually not reclaim, but just claim, like own it instead of trying to push it away. And that is the term woo-woo. I have embraced woo-woo. I'm like, embrace it. Let's like, it's woo-woo. Let's just be that, so that people can't use that as a put down anymore. Right. So that they'll be like, that's really woo-woo. Like, yes, it is. That's my approach to that. And not everyone's in agreement, but I actually think it's very positive and healthy. Like, it is. It's really woo-woo. So is quantum physics.
Yeah, which I think is a really great statement. I think I like that. And if you don't mind, I will borrow it.
Yeah, please do.
Maybe what I do is considered woo-woo, but so is quantum physics. Yep. And I always bristle against it just a little. I am fully woo-woo. I believe in everything and also nothing at all. Yep. And I love the conversation. Oh my God, you know, tell me something woo-woo and I'm into the conversation.
Yeah,
but do I think it's real or not real, true or not true? No. But does it help me get a bigger idea? Does it expand the conversation?
Exactly.
Does it expand the universe? And that's what matters to me personally. But in my professional life, again, when some of the other professionals refer to me as a woo-woo trade, I'm like, no, it's technology that I can teach and is repeatable. It's not magic that may or may not be effective based on whether the wind is blowing a certain way or the moon is in the seventh house. I don't even know what that means. But what I'm saying is, like, for me, again, and it's very personal, you guys absolutely fight with me about this. Does it elevate the conversation?
Yes.
But I like what you just said. Yeah, it's woo-woo, but so is quantum physics. And yeah, that is a recognized science.
Exactly. It, to me, it's like the future is woo, because it really is. It's, to me, it's about there. So if someone's saying that as a put down, they're kind of saying like, it's over here. It's not, it's this. And I'm like, it's woo woo, as is the most advanced science we have. It's, this is the time when spirituality and science, woo woo and science, all stuff is starting to, we're starting to get like that whole mechanistic view of the universe is fundamentally flawed. And we've known that. Science has known that for a long time now.
Yeah, you couldn't be more right. Like, think about string theory. We're talking about multiple realities.
Light's a particle and a wave.
Mention. Spooky action as at a distance is one of those things that Einstein said, because he understood that there are things seem to be happening between bodies, meaning our bodies, between planet bodies, that he at that time couldn't explain. And now we do have more and more explanations for that. And again, repeatable and provable, but repeatable for sure. And I do think that elevates the conversation really to another level, where we can get people thinking and having a different perspective about these. I like to call them trades. I think, I don't know, what do you like to call them? Modality?
Different types of modality. I usually, well, it depends exactly what we're saying, but I would use, like, in terms of a different, like, Reiki, quantum touch, the emotion code, different things, I would call them modalities. Different modalities. But massage therapy is a different, it's a modality, and there's different modalities inside of different types of massage, right?
Yeah. And I think the greater industry is the healing industry.
Yeah.
I think that's the greater industry. And it absolutely is an industry. No question.
Oh, 100%. I mean, it can, so it's complementary and alternative modalities. I don't think it might be medicine. Actually, I'm trying to remember which it is, but that's what the acronym stands for. So the biggest study that's been done in the US so far was in 2004. So that's all, almost 20 years ago, based on a 2002 very big survey that was part of, like the National Institutes of Health and stuff. It was a pretty substantial survey. And then they did, they did a study based on that was published in 2004. So 19 years ago, it showed that 40% of Americans were using at least some complementary and alternative thing. And that was almost 20 years ago. Interestingly, there has not been as comprehensive a study since in the last 20 years, even though in 2021, it was estimated to be a $90 billion industry, billion or more.
We just did an episode with Paul Mills. Paul Mills and Deepak Chopra did a study where they integrated Western medicine and integrative medicine to show scientifically, the benefit or not. So, that is a more recent study showing that. But I think you're right. And I think it's because Western medicine is a little afraid of people moving that direction. But if you look at the efficacy of certain drugs and certain treatments, I would bet they are head to head with alternative medicine in terms of their statistics of efficacy. Cancer treatments.
I think there's a lot to be said for that and the use of it. And again, that's where we need the data, right? So those sort of four pillars that I was talking about, we have to be doing that. We have to do the research, be able to do the comparative. And there's a place for all of it. I'm very far from being a Western medicine basher. Western medicine is extraordinary. Oh my God. I got Lyme disease 12 years ago. I am super grateful for those antibiotics.
Yeah.
That that I don't have chronic Lyme because we figured out it was Lyme. I took the really heavy duty antibiotics for like 6 weeks, but it got rid of it and I don't have Lyme disease. I am very grateful for that. And all kinds of other things as well. It's not about it being this either or. Here's the vision I have. Okay. When I say, like, is this emergence? Is it going to turn into a renaissance or is it going to get shut back underground? Here's a vision. Someone's going in for surgery. You've got the surgeon, surgical team, everything set up. It's all good. And before they start, the surgeon goes, okay, so is the energy healer ready to go too? Okay, yeah. Great. Let's start. That's my vision.
Yeah. And I think that's starting to happen. Yeah. I have heard of nurses that are trained in at least Reiki who are absolutely encouraged and allowed to do their work. The doctors understand that the treatment is more effective. So yeah. I think that's starting to happen. Right now, I'm part of a collective locally of doctors and psychologists, psychotherapists, craniosacral therapists, massage therapists, that we all refer to each other. So many times we will all be seeing the same patient. And, you know, we kind of have it set up where whoever sees them first, we know which practitioner they need to go to next. And it becomes this beautiful holistic, which I think is the real word, treatment, so that all the bases are hit. So oftentimes a person will see five practitioners and they're not talking to each other. So the modalities can't complement. We all have the permission and we share, like, okay, here's where we got to in this session. Now, let's see if their body actually moves better or they'll accept the next treatment better. And the results are astounding, life-changing, what someone would call miraculous. But if that could be the standard of care, that would be incredible. And I think that is what you're advocating for. Am I right?
Yeah, absolutely. Right. And being able to, that's available. It's not, if people aren't interested in that energetic part of it, of course, they don't, you know, need to put it if they want it. It's built, you know, it's part of, I think the time is now, is emerging for what we now, it's funny, we call it traditional medicine. Like, it's really more new medicine, right? Yeah. But for it to truly become integrative, right?
Yeah.
And there, I mean, we probably have to get going pretty soon, but to me, there's three fundamental frontiers in medicine that I think, well, there's AI, there's some other things too, but the three really fundamental frontiers in medicine that I think will profoundly change it. One of them is energy healing to actually get them. The other is mitochondrial science, like really starting to look into the role, like our mitochondria do a lot more for us than just produce the energy of our cells, which is what you're taught in basic biology, you know, and the other is the microbiome. Really understand between the mitochondria and the microbiome, that's like over 80% of the genetic coding that actually runs our bodies on a moment to moment basis. It's not even our own genetic coding that runs us. It's the microbiome. So those three, I think, are going to completely revolutionize the practice of medicine.
Yeah, I agree with you. And we need to have the freedom to explore on all fronts, really explore on all fronts and break the boundaries of what's possible. I think this was what Tesla and Einstein really had going for them is they really had an open-ending question, open-ended, what else is possible?
Yeah.
And they were actively looking for it.
Yeah. And that to me is the very, it's that's the essence of science to me, you know, it's the essence of what makes an incredible life. That's what it's funny you said that, because that's my life, really what my whole life is, what else is possible?
You and me both, sister. All right. We really do have to go. We've run way over time, but it has been so much fun talking to you.
Really Anna. Fun. I'm so glad we did.
And have you back again when the manifesto is complete. We can hear more about it. So until then, everybody, please reach out to Anne at soulpreneursuccesscode.com and find out more. And if you are considering working as a healer, as a professional, seek Anne out and find out how you can do that and start to create a business or support yourself fully from the beginning. Don't suffer. Please don't suffer around this subject. It will only hinder you. Get your feet under you, get some information, and find out how to make that work for you. So thanks again, Anne. Thanks everybody out there in YouTube land, all the podcast platforms land, and UK Health Radio. We'll see you guys again next week.
Thanks for being here with us on the New Life Perspective Radio Show. For more information or to find out more about the work that Bill and I do, please visit us at cognomovement.com or email us at info@cognomovement.com. See you again soon.